Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for those who have given of their time and service, Lord, for the defense of this country, those that still are serving, those that you have called into protecting the rights and the privileges that we have. Father, we thank you for that. Thank you for allowing us to live in this country. I pray that you would help us never to be apathetic, and you would help us to continue to minister and serve you in the midst of the freedoms that we have. May your Holy Spirit use us mightily to be able to reach all that we can reach in the freedoms that you have given us here. Father, we thank you again for those that perhaps are, even in today, are in harm's way. We thank you for their willingness to go, their willingness to serve. We pray that you would grant grace and mercy to them even today. We thank you again for the opportunity to be able to celebrate our freedom in Christ. We thank you for that. We pray that you would bless our time together this morning. I pray that you would fill us with the knowledge of your will and spiritual understanding. We thank you for all that you give us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let's sing together. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Thank you.
reminded in chapter 11, the apostle of the church at Corinth reminds us that he had had a special opportunity to have Jesus Christ tell him what happened on that night. And it says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup." If you're here this morning and you have put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone for your eternal destiny, then we invite you to participate with us. It is a reminder that everything we have, everything we do as a community of believers, as a church, is because of what Jesus Christ accomplished for us. We wouldn't be here, there'd be no reason to be here, if it wasn't for Jesus Christ paying the price for our sin. And because of that, he has called us to come together. He has called us to remember that it was his blood, it was his body that brought us into fellowship with the eternal God. And so today, we remember as we take the lid off of the cup and take just the wafer, it was his body. Beaten beyond recognition, the end of Isaiah chapter 52 reminds us that it was beaten beyond recognition as a man. And we're reminded in Isaiah 53, by his stripes we are healed. And so today we celebrate that. It's a remembrance, it's a memorial, it's a celebration. Yes, it was very grievous at that moment. It was very difficult, so much so that he wept and he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood for you and me. But today we celebrate. Just like we celebrate the freedoms that we enjoy, we celebrate most of all the freedoms that we have in Jesus Christ. The veil has been torn down. The veil has been split from top to bottom, signifying that we have a way to God that even the children of Israel knew nothing about. Today we have that freedom. Jesus Christ is our great high priest. And so he told the disciples, "This is my body which is broken for you." And he told them to eat it all, and I do the same for you, eat the all. It says that he took the cup, and he reminded them that this cup was the blood that would be shed for them, the new covenant. And as part of that, we are reminded that his blood is shed for us, because without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. We've been talking about that, and we'll continue to talk about it as we walk through the Old Testament. But today, we remember it was Christ's blood that brought us freedom. It was Christ's blood that gave us eternal hope. Drink ye all. It's a joyous occasion for us to be able then to stand, be able to once again sing. And as we do that, oh, how he loves you and me. Let's stand together. You can pass the cups to the outside of the aisle as they pick up the cups from you. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he out of everybody. They're just, yeah, we're going to children's church. Yeah, great. So I don't know. That doesn't say for me. But we're glad you didn't leave for children's church. Chapter 32. As we continue our series, it's only been a couple of weeks since God spoke commanding them about keeping his commandments. It's a couple of weeks since the children of Israel have understood that they needed to respond, they needed to obey God's commands that he has given. And I want to talk this morning about spiritual life God's way. Spiritual life God's way. When you look at Exodus 4, Exodus 32, verse 1 through verse 4, it says, "When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people assembled about Aaron and said to him, 'Come, make us a God who will go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him.'" God delayed Moses. Moses is on the mountain. He is delaying from coming down. When mankind tries to tweak how to live in relationship with God, he wrecks the whole design. You can't tweak what God wants. God has commanded what they were to do, how they were to live, how they would be in relationship with him, what he wanted from them. Most of all, he wanted their heart. He wanted their love. He wanted them to know that they could trust him because of his intense love for them. He had called them out all of the people groups of the world. And he said, "You are my people." Demonstrated his love for him in amazing. But the human heart loves something that can be seen. It loves and gratifies desires, its senses. Can I touch it? Can I taste? Can I see it? It is only faith that can endure as seeing him visible. We know that when Jesus spoke to the woman at the well, her, you know, "Your prophets say to worship here, Jewish here," he says, "but I want to tell you something." He says, "If you're going to worship God, you have to recognize he is spirit. And those that worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." So that we have to recognize that it is faith that we accept, we believe that God, that God has come, that he is the creator, that he is the communicator to us, and he has communicated to us through creation. He has communicated to us through his word. He has communicated to us in his son, Jesus Christ. By faith, because none of us were there, by faith we accept that. But it is only faith that can do it, seeing him who is invisible. They couldn't see God. They knew God's presence, right? They had the fire. They had the cloud to know that God's presence was there with them. But they wanted something they could see, they could touch. And as a matter of fact, the one who was communicating God's truth with them was no longer standing in front of them any longer. He's been delayed. I saw him go on the mountain. We don't know what to him, but we got to take matters in hand. I quote the rest of this from C.H. McIntosh in his writing of Exodus. It says, "The human heart loves something that can be seen. It loves that which meets and gratifies the senses. It is only faith that can endure as seeing him who is invisible. Hence, in every age, men have been forward to set up and lead upon human imitations of divine realities. Thus it is we see the counterfeits of corrupt religion multiplied by our eyes. Those things which we know upon the authority of God's word to be divine, heavenly realities, the professing church has transformed into human and earthly imitations. Having become weary of hanging upon an invisible arm, of trusting in an invisible sacrifice, having recourse to an invisible priest, of committing herself at his church to the guiding of an invisible head, the church has set about making these things, and thus from age to age, she has been busily at work with graving tool in hand, graving and fashioning one thing after another until we can at length recognize as little similarity between much that we see around us and what we read in the Word of God. Look in churches around the world. Look in religion around the world. We have graven all kinds of images, all kinds of ways to come into relationship with the living, because we want something we can see, something we can touch. And yet we recognize there's little similarity between much of what we see around us and what we read in the Word as between a molten calf and the God of Israel. But we're quick to say, how could Israel be so foolish? How could Israel? They've just been delivered from Egypt with amazing miracles. They've come through the Red Sea. They've had the God of creation say, this is what I want from you. He has spoken to them. They heard him speak. And now Moses is up there and he's going to write it down for them. But in the midst of this, they say, come, make us a God who will go before us. Something we can see, something we can touch. Something that our limited sight can say, I want this. But listen, we're not that different. If we were that much different, Paul wouldn't have written in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 11, these things happened to them, the Israelites, as an example. Why? So that we would not lust after the same things that they did. They're written for our instruction upon of the age have come. We have raised up all kinds of things to stand before God and in some way represent, and even though it's not carved out of metal or wood, we have erected the things in our life that we treasure most, that we would put ahead of even our fellowship and our worship of one true. Even though we may not form and bow down before a molten calf, Israel's sin is a type of something also in danger of falling into. Otherwise, Paul would not make the statement that he makes in 1 Corinthians. As we look here in from the people, who will go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we don't know what's become of him. What they needed to do was realize the still here, pillar of fire still here. Trust that God is still in our midst. Believe him. You know, we are reminded that Jesus has ascended into the Jesus has ascended and reminds us in order to wait for his return. But sometimes, because of the delay, we get impatient, don't we? Sometimes, even because of the delay in the things of our own life, we get impatient and say, well, God's not fast enough here. I think I need to take it into my own hands. When we're talking about spiritual life, when we're talking about spiritual life with God and living spiritual life God's way, you can't mix your thoughts and your way with his and come out correctly. It's his way or no way. when we look at doing spiritual life God's way, first of all, number one, avoid spiritual compromise. Avoid spiritual compromise. Recognize we cannot compromise. It's only been a matter of weeks since God spoke. But maybe it's only been a few hours since you've opened up the Word of God and you have read His Word, and now you go into the workplace and you're willing to compromise. They were seeking to recognize that they needed to avoid spiritual compromise at all costs. What do they do? Egypt worshipped a visible image. In Egypt, they had polytheism, they had many gods. Now God has called them out and has shown them, I am the one true God. But they wanted to see something visible. So, what do? Aaron says to them, okay, take the gold which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, your daughters, and bring them to me. See, those were probably some of the things that they had gotten from the Egyptians. Remember, they plundered the Egyptians before they left there. The Egyptians basically said, take the stuff and get out of here. We don't want your God anymore here among us because He is an awesome, fearful God. As you look at it, it says, then all the people tore off the gold rings which were in their ears, brought them to Aaron. He took this from their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool. The word fashion there means to manufacture something, to manufacture it by molding a soft substance. When it goes on and it says, and with a graving tool and made it into a molten calf. The word molten there is actually the idea of the fact of it's used other places as gold plating. So more than likely what was done was the wood structure and then the gold plating was put all over it. So they made this, and literally the word calf there is young bull. So they made this young bull, which symbolizes strength and power, and it was something that they would have looked at and said, yes, that's a good, you know what? Our God is an awesome God. He's a powerful God. He's a strong God. Bull, that would be a good symbol for him. That's what we're going to worship. That's what we're going to bow down before. But any visible portrayal of deity compromises the God of all creation. You cannot make Him into some form. That is why He had specifically told them, 20, you look at Exodus chapter 20, we've already gone through it. When you're looking at the Ten Commandments, He reminds them, you shall not make for yourself an idol or any likeness of what is in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the water underneath the earth. Don't try to make something that represents who I am. Don't do that. You can't possibly match me. You can't possibly make something worth it. Charles Hodge reminds us, he says, idolatry consists not only in the worship of false gods, but also in the worship of the true God by images. You can still say, I'm worshiping the God of creation. You can still say, I'm worshiping Jesus Christ. But when you mix images in there and things that are not in the Word of God in there, you corrupt the whole thing. You mess up the whole thing. Any visual portrayal of deity, no created thing can convey God's true character. Such images dishonor God. They distort His glory. I don't care how glorious you make a picture, how wonderful you make a picture of Jesus Christ, you've missed the point. No matter how great you make an edifice of building and how much you put into it, as to this is just so magnificent, this is where I worship God. No, you can worship God just by recognizing that He alone is my Creator. He gave Jesus Christ to die for me. I don't need all the other stuff. I don't need to worship anything else. Such images dishonor God because they distort His glory. This can lead to sin. To worship an image or picture of any person of the Trinity is idolatry, and it veils God's glory. Don't have some trinket, don't have some image that somehow you think that by having this image in my house or in my vehicle or on my person or praying to it, somehow this is going to help me in my spiritual life. Corrupts the whole thing. God says, I'm not going to be put into that mold. An idol can be, when we think of an idol, it can go even beyond it. Anything place ahead of or over alongside God in our lives. That's what they're going to do with this idol. I'll show you in a minute. Too often we think of this idol that they made as something that was totally apart from God. No, this idol was something that they placed alongside of. We'll talk about what synchronism is in just a moment. When we look at it, anything that takes God's place in my thought life. Remember, when the Bible talks about the heart, it's the center of my creative being. It's talking about where I think. It's talking about my creative thoughtlessness. Love the Lord your God with all your heart. It's my center of my thought business. It's out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It's there that I communicate with God and God communicates with me. Anything that takes God's place in our heart, whether it's possessions, careers, relationships, hobbies, sports, entertainment, goals, greed, addictions to alcohol, drugs, gambling, pornography, etc. Anything we seek comfort or hope other than Jesus is our idol. What do I seek comfort in, hope in, when all of a sudden my world is working quite the way I think it should? Am I running to Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith? Am I running to Jesus, who said, "Come unto me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest"? Is that where I get my comfort from, or am I getting my comfort from something else? If I am, then that's what becomes my idol. That's what I run to. That's what I seek. When He has said, "I can be everything for you. I can meet all of your needs." Important to recognize that, like the children of Israel, we many times bring it together. So I have all this other stuff that I run to for comfort, that I seek ahead of God, but I also come to church. I also say, "I've come to worship." See, look at what they say. Look at what Aaron says. He makes this, and he says to him in verse 4, "This is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt." Now, I'm going to just help you just a minute. Doesn't that show how delusional a person is? Seeking anything other than God to really... How delusional can you be? This is what brought you. You just made the bull. Okay? You just created him. How ridiculous is it that this thing you just fashioned, you look at and say, "Wow, he brought us up from Egypt." Where was he 30 seconds ago? Come on. I mean, but we do the same thing. Notice where Aaron goes with this. He says, "Now when Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it." What do you use an altar for? Sacrifice. To worship. He says, "Aaron made a proclamation and said, 'Tomorrow, the feast to Jehovah.'" You'll notice in the rendering that it's all capitalized, showing that it is to Jehovah. It's to Yahweh. And as you look at it, he says, "We're going to make a feast, and we're going to sacrifice." And here is this idol that's representing for it. He brought us up. This idol did it. forsaken, but this is who he is. That's what they're doing. They're saying this is God. Supports the premise that the Bible intended to be a representation of Jehovah. If you just flip over to Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 12, Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 12. Deuteronomy chapter 4, again, rewriting some of the same events and writing about the same events in a little different way. We see that Moses, in writing Deuteronomy chapter 4, says, verse 4, "But you held fast to the Lord your God, are alive today, every one of you," in verse 4, then verse 12, so they're still the Lord God, verse 12, "Then the Lord spoke to you from the midst of the fire. You heard the sound of words, but you saw no form, only a voice." This was what they were doing. And he goes through and he tells them what happened then in God calling them. They were to simply believe God. And he tells them, "The Lord your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God. When you become father of children and children's children have remained long in a land and act corruptly and make an idol in the form of anything and do that which is evil in the sight of the Lord God so as to provoke him." Moses knows that they had done this before. They believed God. They believed in who God, that God existed. But they did not simply leave it and worship him simply as God the way that he had prescribed. They wanted to add their own system to it. They wanted to add stuff to it. This is syncretism. Syncretism is a reconciliation of fusion of differing systems of belief. So I'm going to take, here is part of this belief system, Christianity, and I'm going to fuse that together and somehow come up with something that is better. That's what they're doing. They're looking back at their old way of life, at Egypt, something that was visible for them. They're bringing it in to their present life where God says that he is to be worshipped without an idol, and they say, "No, it would be better if we had an idol." Don't mix what God has said. "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved." Not "believe on Jesus and." Well, there's no more adding to it. There's no more, if you take these steps, then you can have a relationship with God. "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should." Nothing that we can put our hands to can add to what God has already provided. That is one of the reasons why, even when they go to build the temple eventually, we will see that they could not use stone that was chiseled on. Why? Because it's not about your works. It's about what God has already provided. Important to know that. This is the most evident in the areas of gospel religion. It usually results in new teaching or belief system. Obviously, this cannot be reconciled. It cannot be reconciled to biblical Christianity. Syncretism relies on the word of man saying what and how do I have relationship with God. There is moral objectivity, and it is not based on what man thinks. It is based on thus saith. People say, "Well, that's your interpretation." I invite you to come and read it. Not nearly as complicated as it seems. It is simply that we need to accept. Man never rejects God based on the evidence. Man rejects God based on a moral choice. I know that it's true, but I do not want to accept it for me because it means I may have to do things differently. And here, Oh, they served. They went after us. They served their idol with eagerness and energy and personal sacrifice. Here, take the gold. We need this. Have it. We've got to have something to worship. We want to see. People usually find a way to rise early for the things that are really important to them. This shows that Israel was willing to give their time, their sleep, their money in the service of this idol. You want to know what is important to them? What they talk about. Listen to what they will give their time for. You don't understand, Pastor. I don't have time for that. I've got time to go hunting. I don't have time for that. I don't have time for a Bible. You don't understand. No. Anything that we think is important, we will make time for. One thing, if we believe that reading God's Word, studying God's Word is important, we will make time. I just hunting because then I can step on my own toes. You put whatever it is for you out there, okay? It is, we try to mix it. Not only as they walk down through here, look at what happens. The next day they rose early and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. I'm not going to wording here, but the word there is the same idea as when you see the king, you see Isaac with his wife, and a word that is used is play. Doing things with her that the king looked at and said, aha, that's not just your sister, that's not just a friend, that's your wife. So when it uses this word here, he is using it and saying the people sat down to eat and to drink and rose up to improper sexual activity. That was part of what they had known in the land of Egypt. And now they're bringing that into somehow thinking that they're going to worship God that day before this idol. The Lord spoke to Moses. He says, verse 7, go down at once and your people. This is the first time in a long time that God has referred to him as my people. Now he looks at Moses and says, your people. Of is that verse in Hosea chapter 1 where Hosea is naming his children, and one of the names of Hosea's third one, I think it is named Lo-Ami, which means not my people. Because of their sin, because of their turning away from God, and this is so far removed down the road from we see the character of these individuals have not really changed. Oh, it will change right here in just a moment, but down the road, they're right back doing the same thing again. And God says, they're not my people. But there will come a day when Hosea prophesies and says, they will be called Ami, which means my people. As he says, Moses, you got to do something with your people. You brought them from the land of Egypt. They have corrupted themselves. They have quickly turned aside. In other words, there's moral decay from the way which I commanded them. They have made for themselves a molten calf and have worshipped it and have sacrificed to it and said, this is your God, O Israel, who brought you up from the land of Egypt. The Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, they are an obstinate people. The word obstinate there is stiff-necked. They just stiffen their neck. I will not, you know, you go to the child's car seat. You ever seen that one? You know, that stiff neck that says, you didn't put me in that car seat. I've been there before. It's not fun. and you're in a fight. You know, get that head in there. That is what God is saying about Israel. I have given you the commands. All you have to do is follow them, and you are a stiff-necked people. You're obstinate. You won't do it. We look and we see, he says, now then, let me alone. They wouldn't bow to God's authority, but they will willingly bow down to everything else. They won't bow down to the God who loves them and cares for them and only has their best interests. The God who says, listen, you obey, you follow my commands, you worship me only. I will go before you. I will eliminate all your enemies. I will bring you into a place that is flowing with milk and honey, and I will be with you. I will make sure. I know some of you are hoping that we get some rain, okay? See, and God, Israelites, you'll always have what? The former rains and the latter rains. You'll always have the right amount of water. You'll always have amazing, so much that vats will be overflowing. I will bless you in every way. And they look and say, no, this is up from Egypt. God says, let me alone. In other words, let it rest, that my anger may burn against them, that I may destroy them, and I will make of you. Okay, Moses, I know you love me. You just let it rest, let it go. I'm going to destroy all of them, and I'll make a great nation out of you. This is where we see the second principle that comes forward in spiritual with God. You need to practice spiritual intercession. You need to practice spiritual intercession. I'm going to go quick through these, or we're going to have time. Okay. First of all, verse 11. Then Moses entreated the Lord his God and said, O Lord, why does your anger burn against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak, saying, with evil intent he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to destroy them from the face of the earth? Turn from your burning anger and change your mind about what harm you're going to do to your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, whom you swore by yourself and said to them, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heavens, and all this land of which I have spoken I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. Notice here that Moses goes and he begins powerful prayer. This is a powerful evidence that God is responsive to human entreaty. Prayer is not in vain. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. So often we want to use some little petty cliche. My prayer doesn't change the God, it simply changes my God. Wash. That's not what the Word of God teaches. The Word of God teaches can make a real difference. When you go through and you read it repeatedly, God says the reason you don't have is ask. And when you do ask, you ask to consume it on your selfish ambition. Jesus gives a principle for asking. Everyone who seeks finds. Ask and it will be what? Open unto you. There is a responsiveness to the heart. God responds. He does not simply answer prayers concerning what he has already. He is also willing on occasion to alter his resolve and to do otherwise. This in no way infringes on the text that we're reminded of that says, I am the Lord God, I change not. God's character never changes. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change, but he does respond to prayer. And he was going to wipe them out. Moses begins to pray. And as Moses begins to pray, he is going to plead with God. God is in verse 34, but Moses pleads with God on behalf of Israel based upon three things. Number one, based upon God's deliverance of Israel. Why in the world did you bring them out in the first place? If you're going to wipe them out, why'd you do this? Why does your anger burn against your people whom you have brought out of the land? Secondly, his credibility and glory. Think of what the foreign nations are going to think. Think of what the Egyptians are going to think if you do this. It must be he wasn't to get him where he said he was going to take him. Must be he's not as big as he says he was after all. He's not as great as what he claimed. See, it has to do with he's petitioning God based on God's credibility and his glory. He also is based on God's promise. That should be verse 13, not 12. Verse 13, he says, God, what about the promise you made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? God, you're the one who swore that you would do this. It wasn't based on what Abraham did. It wasn't based on what Isaac did. It wasn't based on what Jacob did. You're the one who made a promise and a covenant with them that you would do this. Can we trust you or not? Can anybody trust you, God? See, he goes based on God's character. It goes right back to, if we ask anything according to his will, we know that he hears us and that we have the petitions that we desire of him. It's not just, I want a new Mercedes, God, you're going to give me Mercedes, right? No. Is it according to his will? It is what he desires. Is it for his glory? Is it based on who he is and what he has promised? We need to remember, too, that even in intercession, there can be discipline. I'm not going to read all of the passage here, but when you flip over to chapter 32 and verse 33, verse 32 says, but now if you will forgive their sin, and if not, please blot me out of your book, which you have written. Again, Moses is still talking to God. He says, the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot him out of the book. That he was continuing to worship the false image. That they were genuine, those who were sincere. You go back to verse 26, same chapter. Says, then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, whoever is for the Lord, come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered together. And you see in verse 28, so the sons of Levi did as Moses instructed, about 3,000 men of the people fell that day. Oh, there was judgment. There people died because they forsook doing it the way God said. God has the right to do that. He alone is worthy of our worship. He does not want competition. When he says, God's before me, that doesn't mean to. It literally means you will bring no other God before my face. It's not that God's your number one. No, there are no others. Period. Don't have any other ones before my face. We see that Moses pleaded with God and God responded to him. We should practice spiritual repentance. So the children of Israel, in chapter 33, verses 1 through 17, we see that in verse 3 it says, go up to the land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go up in your midst. God tells Moses, communicate to the children here, I'm not going up in your midst. Remember before that, God was in their midst. God says, I'm not going to be in their midst. Why? Because you're an obstacle, and I might destroy you on the way. The fact that God would not be in their midst because of rebellion against him broke the people's heart. Look at what it says in verse 4. When the people heard this, they went into mourning, and one of them his ornament. And they went into mourning, and we don't want anything. The things that we gave for the idea that we gave this gold to make this idol, we're not even going to put any of that stuff on. We don't want that stuff. We just want to worship you, God. We just want you. And we want you to be in our midst, because if you're not in our midst, we're not going. We can't make it. And you can try to go through life on your own. You can do pretty good. I can get through. But there's going to be times when you're going to need God in your midst. It involves repentance. It involves brokenness. We practice spiritual repentance. Genuine repentance always involves brokenness. David reminds us that when he did not repent, it caused a terrible groaning in his body, physically affected him in Psalm 32. But we see that when he did repent, he said, "Against thee and thee only have I sinned." There was a brokenness over recognizing that first and foremost, all sin is against the holy God. He needed to repent of that. There's no such thing as genuine repentance, brokenness over sin in our life. Recognizing that it is a front against a holy God. Genuine repentance always involves obedience. God goes through and he tells the children of Israel what they're to do. And all the children agree, this is what we'll do. And because of it, you have Moses once again praying in chapter 33 and verse 13. He says, "Now therefore I pray you, if I have found favor in your sight, let me know your ways, that I may know you, so that I may find favor in your sight. Consider too that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence shall go with you. I will give you rest." Verse 16, "For how then can it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not by your going with us, so that we, I and your people, may be distinguished from all the other people who are upon the face of the earth?" The Lord said to Moses, "I will also do this thing of which you have spoken, for you have found favor in my sight, and I have known your name." There's a lot that could be said just about that phrase and what Moses is going to want to see the glory of the Lord. But genuine repentance always involves obedience. And genuine repentance always involves a response from God. God responded. The people did what they needed to do. He responded with Moses prayed on behalf of the people, and that we, and that I and the people will do this. And because of it, there was opportunity then to participate in spiritual renewal. Number four, they could participate in spiritual renewal because of what they had done. First of all, intercessory prayer by Moses, and then them communicating their obedience. Genuine repentance. We see that they participated in a spiritual renewal. It involved prayer. Moses prayed for himself and the people. It involved the assurance of God's presence. It involved obedience. So God says to him, chapter 34, you go through chapter 34, he writes the tablets. Again, we have the tablets of stone, the words written on them. Moses here has the tablets. The Lord descends. The Lord passed in front of him. "Proclaim the Lord God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and kindness and truth, who keeps love and kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquity, transgression, and sin. Yet he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished." He already demonstrated that. He already demonstrated. 3,000 of them died. He says, "Visiting the iniquity on the fathers of the children, on the grandchildren, to the third and fourth generations, Moses made haste to bow low toward the earth and worshiped." Then God said, chapter 34, verse 10, "Then God said, behold, I am going to make a covenant." And he is going to reiterate everything that he told them. He is going to reiterate how that they are to watch for themselves, how that they are not to make any gods, how that they're not to make any molten image. Do this again, and they're able to have spiritual renewal, so that once again, God is working with them. They're worshiping the true God because they have responded to God's judgment on them. As a matter of fact, he gives them all of the commands that they're to do, including the Sabbath, including the offspring and worship and sacrifice. And chapter 34, verse 24, the fact that he would drive out the nations before them, that they're to bring the first fruits of their offering. So there was 40 days, 40 nights that Moses is there, doesn't eat, doesn't drink. And on there we have the Ten Commandments. Verse 29, it came about when Moses was coming down from Mount Sinai, the two tablets of the testimony were in Moses' hand as he was coming down from the mountain, that Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because of his speaking with him. So when Aaron and all the sons of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. Then Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the rulers in the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke to them. Here we see that when Moses spent time with God, it was evident in his physical presence. You know what? What a tremendous illustration that is, that when we spend time with God, it ought to be evidenced so that people looking at us can say, there is something unique about that individual. Why do they look that way? Why in the face of adversity are they still joyful? Why when things should be against them are they still praising God? It ought to be evident that we have spent time with God. Don't complicate the spiritual life that God wants to share with you by adding man's ideas. Don't complicate it about what should happen. Don't say, this is how I think I should be able to come into a relationship with God. No. Just accept what God has done. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Jesus reminds us that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but him. And he calls us to live a life of obedience. A holy life. A life that others can look at and say, I believe there's something uniquely different there. Why are you doing it? It's because of Jesus in my life. It's because of the grace of God. It's not because of who I am. It's because I have a great God who sent Jesus Christ to die for me. Enjoy the presence of God in your life even if you can't see him. Even if there's times when maybe there's a delay, don't run somewhere else. Trust him with your life. Trust him with your eternal destiny. You can know he is there because he has promised that he would never leave you or forsake you. Know the power of intercessory prayer. Know the power of not only praying for yourself, but for praying for others. Plead before God for others. Keep short accounts with God. You sin? Confess your sin. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. By confession and repentance is how we keep those short accounts. And then, like Israel, from time to time, when they would do this, then they got to enjoy spiritual life God's way. And so can you. You can enjoy the peace of God that passes all understanding. You can know that if you were to die today, you can spend forever with God in eternity. But it has to be spiritual life God's way. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. Father, I thank you for the greatest sacrifice that you have ever given in your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to go to the cross. I pray that if there's any here that have never put their faith and trust in you, that today they would trust the payment that your Son made as the only way to have eternal life. And even today that they would cry out to you, and even today they would say, Father, I know that I am a sinner. I can't save myself. And today I trust Jesus Christ alone for my eternal destiny. Father, thank you for the joy that comes because of a relationship with you. Thank you for the joy of being able to live in this world even today, knowing that you are still in control, even though our world may look like it's out of control. Father, thank you again for the opportunity to live in the United States of America and the freedoms that we have. Thank you for those who have served. Thank you for those who have given of their time and resources and maybe even their life so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we have here. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.